Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our second panel session. I'm delighted to be joined by an esteemed panel, and we're going to be following the same format as the first panel. So I'll remind people just to please switch mobile phones off,
right,
but please, or at least silent, but do please continue to tweet as you have been doing early this morning. In this session, we will be exploring the current and the future challenges of making Britain more cyber resilient. We're going to be sharing ideas of how we can work better together across those common challenges. And we're going to be discussing and hopefully having an active, interactive debate around roles, capabilities, and accountabilities between the public and the private sector. I no doubt think we'll be talking about regulation, the role of insurance as well. And as I said, what we're going to be doing is following the same format. I'm going to introduce Natalie, Jonathan, and Ruth, and they'll speak for about 10 minutes each, and then we'll open it up to questions. So please do start thinking. So I'm delighted to start by introducing Natalie. Natalie Black is the Director of the Office of Cybersecurity and Information Assurance in the Cabinet Office, supporting ministers in setting national strategy and coordinating the delivery of the National Cybersecurity Programme. She was previously the Deputy Director responsible for cyber defence and incident management and led the setup of the UK's first UK CERT, which also hosts the Cyber Information Sharing Partnership, a partnership I know many of you will be familiar with. So with that, I'd like to invite Natalie up and thank her again for her time this morning.
Good morning, everyone. I think I've turned my phone off, but in all honesty, I'm not sure. So if that bag rings over there, I'll fess up now. First of all, let me start by thanking Reform and BT for arranging and hosting this event today. You've really brought together a great set of people, and I'm looking forward to a very interactive and lively discussion. But also let me thank, in particular, KPMG, especially Curtis and Paul Dixon, who I'm sure is in the audience somewhere, for sponsoring this panel. This is really the public-private collaboration that we're going to be talking about today. As you heard from Minister Ed Fazey this morning, good cybersecurity underpins the entire digital economy. We need it to keep our businesses, citizens, and public services safe. Because the UK is a world leader in the use of digital technologies, we also need to be a world leader in cybersecurity. Trust and confidence in the UK online security is crucial for consumers, businesses, and investors. This is why the government is investing £860 million in the National Cybersecurity Programme to protect and promote the UK. Just this morning, the Minister announced three new measures. You'll be glad to know I'm not going to test you on what they are, but I'll remind you now. A cybersecurity innovation voucher scheme worth £1 million, a cybersecurity knowledge transfer pilot worth £500,000, and an Inspired Careers new online hub to promote the cybersecurity profession. In this session, we will be focusing on protecting against security breaches. So I'd like to highlight some of the work of the National Cybersecurity Programme has undertaken with industry, academia, individuals, and across government to promote best practice and guidance, share information, and provide support when incidents do occur. I suspect I'm preaching to the converted when I say the challenge we face from the cyber threat is increasingly vast and complex. The most recent Information Security Breaches Survey shows that 90% of large organisations and 74% of small businesses reported an information security breach last year. The fact of you, some of you are smiling, makes me realise that quite a few people have given you that stat this morning. But unfortunately, it is all incredibly very serious. However, the good news is that the majority of breaches remain unsophisticated and could be prevented by employing simple hygiene measures, whether it's ensuring passwords are regularly updated and kept secure, or making sure that antivirus software is updated. Together, we have to keep banging the drum that the most basic measures can make the biggest difference. On this basis, the government has worked with industry to produce a suite of guidance and advice that supports businesses of any size and in any sector to improve their cybersecurity. The cornerstone of this is the 10 steps to cybersecurity, which I hope many of you have seen, as it clearly does what it says on the can. 10 simple things that all organisations can do to improve their cybersecurity. To help organisations, large and small, go through this process, last year we launched Cyber Essentials as a joint government-industry initiative. It's a certification process that helps organisations project confidence to their customers and suppliers that they are protected against the vast majority of unsophisticated attacks. As the Minister said this morning, hundreds of businesses, including many FTSE 100s, have already got Cyber Essentials. Firms like Vodafone, Barclays, GlaxoSmithKline, Standard Charter, and National Grid. So if you take away one action today, I would really encourage you to look at Cyber Essentials for your organisation if you haven't already. And it's important for me to say that within government, we are practising what we preach, so that suppliers to government of many contracts and services are now required to hold a Cyber Essentials certificate. But as we know, no organisation is an island in cyberspace. So government and industry is working together to increase information sharing about the threats and vulnerabilities we face. The Cyber Information Sharing Partnership is an online secure platform that allows real-time information sharing. It's played a crucial role in helping organisations deal with some of the challenges we have faced over the past year, including Heartbleed and Shellshock. Demand for membership is extremely high, and at only 2 years old, it has over 1,000 organisations and 3,000 individual members. We have also found that information sharing is crucial to developing new tools against the cyber threat, including cyber insurance. Recently, the Cabinet Office jointly published a report with the insurance industry. It sets out how insurers can help firms better manage their cyber risks. By asking the right questions and educating clients, insurers can help drive the adoption of cybersecurity best practice like Cyber Essentials. And participants in the report have agreed to include Cyber Essentials certification as part of their cyber risk assessments for SMEs. So in closing, there is a lot more we can do to protect against security breaches, and I hope you take away from this session in particular some practical next steps. But given the nature of the threat, we do need to recognise that we will never be 100% protected. For this reason, we also need to ensure that we have the right incident response and recovery plans in place, and they are well exercised. Just over a year ago, we set up Cert UK, the national organisation to manage national cybersecurity incidents, with a particular focus on critical national infrastructure, and it is overseeing a detailed programme of exercising for this purpose. There's obviously a lot more I could say on this subject, but I think it's time to hear from some of the other panellists, and I look forward to the discussion. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Natalie, thank you very much indeed. And it's now my pleasure to introduce Jonathan Lloyd-White. Jonathan is the Director of Security and Information at HMRC. His team is responsible for developing the strategy and the policy for information management and security, and for a range of other operational services, including business continuity, personal vetting, assurance, and incident management. And he's also the government head of profession for security. Jonathan.
Great, thanks, Curtis. Good morning, everybody. I thought I would try and give you a bit of a personal perspective on what it's like being the security director of a large organisation like HMRC. Is that what you want to hear about? Is that okay? Good. I hope I can start by saying that you are all my customers. I hope that's the case. I'm responsible for all your data, so that sort of puts it into sharp focus. We're an organisation of around 60,000 people. We collect over £500 billion of tax a year. And we sit on quite a lot of your data as well, everything from your personal tax affairs as an individual, business accounts, pensions, payrolls, pretty much everything about you and the world that you're in. So a very large amount of data that we hold. We also collect all the money that drives public services. So we are a key part of the critical national infrastructure. So as you can imagine, security is kind of important to us. HMRC takes security very, very seriously. It's in our DNA. It's part of our legislation. It's enshrined in the Commissioners of Revenue and Customs Act. That means if I call it wrong, I can end up in jail for 2 years, and that serves to focus the mind, I'm sure you understand. We have a very strong security culture in HMRC. We have a good reporting culture. We have lots of conversations about security in the organisation all the time. And I have a lot of conversations with my board about security. I don't have to shout to get attention on this subject, which I think is great. We spend a lot of time talking at the board level about risk appetite and about how we keep pace with change. And I also hold board members to account for their performance in the area of security. So it's definitely part of our agenda all day, every day. But we have to balance that with our aim to provide excellent customer service and an excellent customer experience online. So I'll give you some examples of that. So following on from some of the excellent conversation this morning, our aim is to make your data as open to you as we can. And we're doing that by providing online tax accounts. Some of those are in beta, some of them are available now, and you can access your own data and see what's happening in your own tax affairs. That's growing, and we want to do more of that. We're also trying to stop the bad habit of asking for your data from you over and over again. So we're looking to collect our data in one place and provide it back to you so that we don't keep repeating the same questions. And we're looking to get much better at tailoring our services to you, making our guidance more tailored to you, and if I put a slightly harder edge on it, being more persuasive with some of our guidance in a way which is very tailored to your circumstances. And we want to do all of that at reduced cost to you as the taxpayer and deliver these services in a more cost-effective way. So to do that, we need to invest very heavily in digital services and the data analytics that sit behind that. And we also need to keep our security in step with those changes. So I was just going to spend a few moments talking about some of the investments that we're making in the security area, partly funded internally and partly calling on the National Cybersecurity Programme that Natalie's just spoken about. And I'll just mention a few of the things that we're investing in. So I touched briefly there on the subject of data analytics. We hold this vast amount of data. Making best use of that is always a challenge. So what we're aiming to do now is consolidate all our data into one place on a Hadoop platform to allow us to analyze and interrogate all that data more effectively. That brings security challenges, as you can imagine, putting all our analytical data in one place. But it also provides a huge opportunity for security improvements. So we're really innovating in this area, bringing in new encryption and tokenization techniques that allow me as the security director in HMRC to have much more granular view of what's going on in that analytical environment. So we can allocate data access to specific people in a much more refined way than we have in the past. So whilst using things like Hadoop brings its challenges, it also has huge security benefits. We're also using big data to watch big data. So we are introducing much better monitoring about what's going on internally within HMRC using big data analytics, and also turning that big data analytics on what's happening across our networks. So that's a really fascinating, innovative space for security. We're also using that monitoring to understand about fraud more, understand what's happening on our boundaries. And also it allows us to alert customers where we see things like out-of-date browsers or potential malware. And we have a process now for alerting customers where we suspect they are the victim of fraud. We're also investing in a cybersecurity command center that brings together all that monitoring into one place and gives us a really sharp focus on what's happening on our networks in a way in which we've not been able to do in the past. So that's kind of the technical stuff. I wanted to stop briefly on the subject of professionalism and capability, another hot topic for me. If I could split that into the sort of specialist area, where as head of profession, I'm looking to grow good career paths for security professionals in government, but also for our staff, all staff. We've got training and education programs across HMRC that try and raise awareness of issues like phishing. So we've been running internal phishing simulations on our staff. They really love me for that, I can tell you, where we send out fake phishing emails and get people to click on the link. And if they do click on that link, then that takes them to the training package. It's a real vote winner, I can tell you. The other thing that I'm really focused on, and I've got a blog where you can pick up on some of this, is around diversity in the security world, security profession. And I'm delighted not to be amongst three blokes on the panel this morning, which is great. We are a much more diverse workforce than we used to be, but still have a long way to go. So that's another key focus for me. Another big topic is around assurance of new services that come online. You may have seen in the press recently that we've just started rolling out Google Apps for collaboration within HMRC. That was I felt brave making that decision. Happy to talk about that in a moment. And lots of other innovative areas where we're pushing the boundary of what it's usual for a fairly risk-averse organisation like HMRC to do. And then I'll just finish on some partnership points, partnerships across government and partnerships with suppliers and with industry. So we have a very wide, diverse range of suppliers that we call on in HMRC, from very large organisations to smaller organisations. And I think we've got a big role to play in driving the security agenda with those suppliers, setting the standards that we expect and assuring them to the highest levels. Across government, Natalie's mentioned this already, we do a lot of sharing already in threat intelligence sharing, sharing experience on developing tools, in developing techniques, and also on skills. So I think a good story from government around how we're joined up on cyber, but always lots more to do. And I look forward to your questions. Thank you.
Jonathan, thank you very much. I don't have a blog. I feel I should have one. Everyone has one. I do know for one thing, I think I would like one of those pothole sensors that were spoken about earlier. I think they'd be fantastic. Jonathan, thank you very much for that. And last, but by no means least, I'm delighted to introduce Ruth Davis. Ruth is the head of program Cyber, Justice and National Security for Tech UK. Tech UK is a trade association for digital technology industry. And Ruth has a background in political research and business. She joined Tech UK from Policy Exchange, where she worked as a research fellow in the Crime and Justice Unit. And prior to that, she was advising the Home Affairs Select Committee on its borders and immigration and on cyber crime. Please join me in welcoming Ruth.
Thank you, Curtis. Thanks, Curtis, and hi, everybody. It's good to be here today. One of the main inhibitors, I think, of greater resilience against cyber attacks is the perception that security is a cost or a blocker to getting things done. And I think this is a problem that both public and private sectors, as well as consumers, suffer from. We know that the public sector sees it as a blocker. Tech UK recently carried out a survey of over 1,000 civil servants to gauge their views on how important technology was to their work, how effective their departments were at leveraging it, and how thorough their engagement with industry was. Tellingly, we found that nearly 70% of senior civil servants saw security as a blocker to their effective use of IT. And I think that helps to understand this in the context of a culture which is more often than not taken quite a risk-averse approach to this issue, rather than managing it, certainly historically, but we appreciate that that's changing a lot now. A former parliamentary colleague of mine was recently on a secondment to a Whitehall department, and she was very surprised to find that the security policy at her department was so restrictive that she was unable to access research sites online and also unable to stream debates live from the House of Commons and from the Parliament's website. Now, anybody who's experienced some of the more soporific qualities of some of the House of Commons debates, like myself, may well understand why a department may want to shield their people from that. But I don't think we can really count it as a security risk. I think this is also an issue for business and consumers, though.
many times we see sort of security cited as an overhead. We also see sort of a lack of a perceived imminent threat, or a view that the company data has little value outside of the organisation, all as reasons why companies aren't investing more in cyber. And our own research backs this up. We did a recent study with Symantec that discovered that 78% of the businesses we surveyed thought they were at risk from cyber attack, yet less than half were providing regular training for employees. 81% thought that the cyber threat was growing, but only 53% planned to increase and adapt their security measures to match this. And I think a really key role for industry in supporting the public sector is to help to counter this narrative of seeing security as a blocker or as a cost. And I think the first thing we need to do is think about the language we use. We talk about DDoS attacks, zero-day attacks, APTs, and these don't mean anything to normal people and to most businesses. Cyber itself is a term, I think, that's very confusing to a lot of people, and there's been some effort to try and improve this with terms like e-crime, cyber-dependent crime, cyber-enabled crime, and the more new term of digital security. I think the second thing we need to do is to look at the narrative we are building, which also, I think, needs some serious work to address. At the moment, it's all based around fear, uncertainty, and doubt, and I think there's only so much of that that people really absorb. And I don't think we can rely on sort of public discourse, certainly in the mainstream media, to help us here. I think as industry, we have to be very proactive and to lead this. Certainly, sort of recent headlines don't seem to suggest that. I think the Daily Mail's offering last year was killer robots and crippling cyber attacks, how the world is going to end. Or, a touch dramatic, I thought, but, or perhaps another one, attack of the refrigerators, the cyber threats lurking in your home. Though I think, and I did Google quite a lot of these, but I think the most disturbing one I found actually came from the International Business Times. Hacker who stole nude self-portraits of George W. Bush, jailed for 4 years. Though one would have thought the poor man had suffered enough, I'd have thought, but there we go. Instead of focusing, I think, on these alarmist stories, I think we need to concentrate on how security can be a business enabler, something that can help you increase your profitability. Cyber resilience can be a compelling advantage for businesses. Improving efficiency can be a driver for enhanced efficiency and productivity. It can give you better visibility of your information assets, which can help you both protect and also exploit them. A controlled and modernized IT estate saves money. An effective mobile security policy enables workers to be more effective and it's more cost efficient. And migrating to the cloud can reduce your storage costs of data and offer a very centralized way to secure your enterprise. And then finally, of course, there's the issue of reputation. Paul Theroux once said, gain a modest reputation for being unreliable and you'll never be asked to do a thing. Research finds significant spikes in customer churn following a cyber breach. Strong security is vital to making sure that customers are attained and retained. And I think having high accredited security standards is increasingly attractive to many corporate and government customers. And also to for small companies who are often part of very long supply chains to big SIs and primes, this is now something that their system integrators are increasingly looking for, as many companies have been attacked through smaller components of their supply chain. And I think government has done a lot of good work, and we've heard about quite a lot of it today, to make cybersecurity more comprehensible to people. It's developed Cyber Essentials, the baseline standard. It's developed consumer-focused resources. We heard about Cyber Street to help improve public awareness. And it's also taking steps to help businesses help themselves through organisations like the London Digital Security Centre, which I know we'll hear about more in the next panel from its director, Mandy Hayburn-Little. And this is very much a one-stop shop to help SMEs in London improve and test their digital security. And I think we as industry have a role to help government promote these and to help them to reach a wider audience. Tech UK, for example, our cyber programme is working with a Federation of Small Businesses to run cloud clinics for SMEs in the southeast and London. That will be the first one, helping them to understand what cloud can do for their business, but also how to have confidence in choosing a safe and secure cloud provider. And there are two particular areas that I think industry can work with the public sector to a greater extent. The first is making it really easy for people to access cybersecurity advice, dropping it into their daily lives instead of something they have to go off and do. And also to help signpost people to what to do when things go wrong. There are a lot of organisations involved in distributing cybersecurity advice at the moment, and I think this can become confusing for a lot of people, particularly for businesses. More cyber-savvy businesses will be members of the CISP or perhaps a sector-specific organisation, but a lot of them won't be. And I think our role as industry is to coalesce behind a successful initiative that makes it easier for businesses to find out both where to go for advice and to access companies who can help them implement it and to help them if something goes wrong. A good option for this might be to roll out digital security centres in major cities. They can act as a hub for SMEs and connect them to providers. And then where to go when things go wrong, when you think you've been hacked, when you think you've had money stolen from your account. So how can you report a crime committed online? Well, if you provide a significant section of the UK's CNI, you already have these relationships. But if you're in a small business or you're a consumer, where do you go? Well, you could report it to Action Fraud, which is the big online central reporting system in the UK. But that's only if it's a financially motivated cybercrime. If you're being stalked on social media or something like that, you need to report it to your local police force. If you try to do that for an online fraud, however, your local force will refer you back to Action Fraud, who will then triage the case and decide if there are any viable leads to follow. If there are, they'll decide whether that's serious enough to go to the National Crime Agency or a regional organised crime unit. Otherwise, it's going straight back to your local force who refused to take it from you in the first place and referred you to Action Fraud. Now, I don't know if anyone's feeling a bit confused after that. I know I certainly am, and I think it's an area that we need to work on. And I think this brings us to the second area in which suppliers can help support the public sector, and that's helping to tackle volume cybercrime. The UK is widely acknowledged as having really world-leading capability when it comes to dealing with sort of serious and organised crime, the very high end. We've got fantastic capability in the NCA and its partners. But we have a patchy and in some places quite a poor record of dealing with less serious crimes, such as small frauds. And there are several reasons for this. Our data on it isn't good. People don't report them. Often when they do, there are no viable leads for the police to follow. Police resources out of specialist units are highly constrained. And sometimes you reach a dead end when the perpetrators are based overseas and there's little possibility of extradition, either because of the country they're operating from or because just financially the costs just won't weigh up. We've been speaking to the City of London Police, who've told us that nearly 250,000 crimes were reported to Action Fraud last year. Of these, only 70,000 were allocated to either the NCA or local police forces, and only 12,000 of these resulted in a judicial outcome. So only 30% of reported cybercrimes were investigated, and less than 17% of these resulted in a judicial outcome. And remember, this is only financially motivated crimes. This has nothing to do with harassment or stalking or anything like that on social media. So the sheer volume of these crimes make it incredibly unlikely that police forces will be able to effectively deal with them alone, especially with the sort of reductions to budgets that we're seeing. And we need to move to a prevention-based model, but I think we also need to look at innovative ways in which industry can assist police forces with both prevention and investigation, the technical side of it, so that they can make the legal and law enforcement decisions. Tech UK is undertaking research on this at the moment, and we will be shortly publishing some recommendations for how such a partnership might work, and hope that will start an interesting conversation. I'm aware that I must almost be out of time, so I just want to mention very, very quickly one area in which I think the public sector can help market forces make the UK a secure place to do business online. And that's by encouraging innovation to help grow a strong and vibrant cybersecurity supplier base in the UK. And I think, as we've heard this morning, the government has shown very strong commitment to this, especially through the Cyber Growth Partnership. It's funded a network of small and start-up cybersecurity companies called CyberConnect, which is run out of Tech UK. and gives companies access to business acceleration workshops, access to finance clinics, export opportunities, and a lot more. It will also shortly be producing an online cyber tech map that for the first time will map every cyber security supplier in the UK on an online map and enable people to search by location and by capability to give us a much better idea of the market, where we're strongest and where we perhaps need some further work to encourage it. So I think to sum up, clearer language, a positive case for cybersecurity, streamlining efforts, and a new model for tackling cybercrime. All are important ways in which further public-private sector cooperation can strengthen the UK's resilience. All of this, however, will be underpinned by working together for a vibrant, a dynamic cybersecurity sector in the UK. Thank you.
Ruth, thank you very much indeed. And fascinating to hear how we approach cybersecurity, cyber resilience at the national level, at a UK government department level, and then through our partnership, public sector to private sector, through a trade association as influential as Tech UK. So three very unique, but as we've seen, very interdependent perspectives across a very broad range of issues. I think we've covered a huge number of topics there. As I made loads of notes, which is usually a good sign of a panel session, I won't sum up now because I would like to open it up to questions. As often happens, I think being interactive and hearing from the audience is really where the value also comes. So with that, let me open it up. We'll take two or three, pull them together. On my right. And if you can just introduce yourself. Thank you.
Oh, hello. Yeah, my name's Steve Pilkington from Ultra Electronics. Ruth touched on it just very briefly in her presentation, but my question is to Jonathan. It's around supply chain. How do you ensure the thousands of companies that you deal with have the right processes in place to ensure that they can do good business with you? Do you see it as a threat? The perception is that it could be a massive threat, but is it as big as it seems to be?
Okay, thank you. We'll take just another one, and then the questions that we've got. Yes, sorry, in the centre. I'll come to you after. Yeah, thank you.
So kind of national government level, how do, as we move into a more digital, sorry, my name's Nicola from Deloitte, how do you ensure whilst we move to a digital information era that, in terms of touching on the supply chain, but also how you protect that data from security breaches or even from corruption, how do you make sure that the data you get is accurate and then you secure it?
Okay, thank you for that. We'll come back to you in just a moment. So two great questions, supply chain assurance, and how do you actually, validate the quality of the data and then protect it? Jonathan, can we start with you?
Yeah, thank you. Supply chain threat or opportunity? I guess it depends what mood I'm in, really, and what's happened within the last 24 hours. It's a little dry and bureaucratic, perhaps, but the way in which we issue tenders, the way in which we set out our security requirements at the very start of an engagement is critically important. How we go about setting out our requirements clearly in contracts, also a key component. But probably more important than all that is the relationship that we build with suppliers through the life cycle and how we go about gaining assurance. And there's not one size fits all here. We're trying very hard to break away from laying out the same standards that we'd give to a huge multinational to a small SME, small and medium enterprise. So it's trying to make sure that our requirements fit the risk and the part of the supply chain. That's not easy, but that's what we're striving to do.
Ruth, can I invite you to comment?
Yeah, I think the key thing is making sure we use more standards in contracting, and I think we're seeing that increasingly. But as Jonathan was saying, we need to make sure that we are using sensible ones for the size of the company. Now, we know the defence industry is working on the Defence Cyber Protection Partnership, which is all about rolling out standards of cybersecurity down the defence supply chain, which is a difficult issue which that's tackling. And I think we will see that replicated in more industries. We know government's going to be using cyber essentials in in more of its contracts, and I certainly can see sort of cybersecurity standards being used more and more in prime contractors as well with their suppliers.
Great. And Natalie, from a national perspective, what are the challenges you see in terms of, we talked a little bit about quality of data and how do you authenticate data, how do you validate that, and then how do you better protect it? What are the challenges that you're seeing at a national level?
I mean, this is really the crux of the matter. This is why we're all here and this is what we're trying to do. And the volume of data that is now going through government is absolutely mind-boggling, and it's incredibly impressive that people like Jonathan have to tackle this every single day, and they are trying to produce the best public service they can. From the centre, so the Cabinet Office sets out a government security policy to set standards and requirements, and then there is a process to manage the information risk around that. But to go back to Ruth's point, is what we need to make sure is that there's the sufficient flexibility so informed individuals can make judgments. And then we go back to the point about making sure that those individuals who have to make informed decisions are suitably trained and have the professionalism support that we're trying to roll out across the civil service. Now, that's a massive undertaking. There are lots of problems with it. But I think what you've seen in the last couple of years, a real step up, a bit of an honest reflection on where we are, and a real ambition to take the digital agenda head on and make sure that we incorporate security as a key component of that.
Great, thank you very much indeed. I know we had a question to my left.
Hi there, it's Lauren from Aviva again, sorry. So it's just a question about the EU data protection regulation, specifically on fraud, so this is financial services specific. There's an element in there around the right to be forgotten, which could prevent us from looking at fraud and being able to investigate it properly. And I just wondered what your views were on that element of the data protection regulation, if you are involved with it.
Thank you very much. I'll take one more question and then I'll open it to the panel. None at the moment. Let's open that up. An interesting question around the right to be forgotten and how that might or might not impede on our ability to track fraud and prevent fraud. Ruth, can I start with you?
Yeah, certainly. It's not a provision I've been engaging with myself, but we have looked at the right to be forgotten. We have said that we don't think it really works. I mean, it's really the right not to be, you know, Googled for or whatever. It's not actually a thing. And I think that we have a number of concerns about the new data protection regulations coming through and certainly enabling people to still be able to run analytics and to look for patterns of fraud is very important, and we don't want to undermine our security through that.
Thank you. Natalie?
So I had a bet how quickly a question like this would come up. So I think I've won myself, but I'm not sure what that is. I would take the same approach. I'm afraid I'm going to skirt this a little bit because it is quite specific. But I think there's a broader point here about the range of European regulation that is currently being debated at the moment. From a UK government point of view, we are obviously engaging with that very seriously. I mean, it would go back to my point that it's a pretty glib, but no one is an island in cyberspace. We have to watch very closely how the European regulation develops. But there are some concerns there on the current status, particularly around the fact that it could end up being quite onerous on UK companies and UK companies that operate globally. So as I say, we're taking a close interest in that, and we'll have to see how it plays out in the next few months.
Yeah, some interesting tensions at play around privacy versus how we protect individuals versus how we protect the UK as a whole, and then how do we balance that against convenience? Consumers want, you know, security. It's a hygiene factor, I think we talked about, and how do we make it easy for people to do business with us? Jonathan, I guess a lot of this goes to the heart of what you do, specifically around fraud prevention. Mm. How are HMRC addressing that?
It's perhaps not news that the tax department never forgets.
Some worried faces now in the
audience. Yes, that's right.
So just look around.
I'm sure that EU data regulation won't apply to tax data, unfortunately. I suppose the other thing to say from a tax department is that you give us your data in a way which is unlike other data sharing relationships between customer and company. You have an obligation, you have a legal obligation to give us your data. So that puts us in a very different place to most other organisations when it comes to data handling issues. So unfortunately, no right to be forgotten when it comes to tax.
A sigh of relief across the audience, I'm sure. Okay, very good. Question in the front, thank you. And one at the back afterwards, thank you.
Hi, Charlie.
Oh, just wait a moment, just for the, that's okay.
Charlie Pickles from Reform, so apologies for stealing a question, as obviously we're hosting it. I'm very interested in what a few of the panellists have picked up on, both in this session and the previous one, around the kind of balance between the individual, be that a corporate entity or a personal individual, and the organisation that's dealing with data and people's information. And I was particularly interested, Ruth, in you kind of talking about the kind of gulf between what people kind of are worried about and what they expect and what they're almost willing to do or understanding what they need to do themselves. And I also loved the idea of the fake phishing emails. I thought that was fantastic that HMRC are doing. And I think it links to a question on the previous panel around kind of liability and who is responsible for breaches or poor quality information and those kind of things. And I just wondered whether you, all three panelists, would kind of comment on that and that balance between individual and the data holder.
Okay. Perfect. Fantastic. Just at the back, thank you.
Hello, Ken Hall at KPMG. Heard a lot of best practice going on here. So you've talked about doing the basics with Cyber Essentials, Cyber Essentials Plus, great. We've heard a lot about the behavior and the phishing emails and what's best practice there about testing your staff. That's great, that gets you to a certain level, but this is about protecting against security breaches. HMRC really is the honeypot. The data is huge value. There's what goes on in the background, the low and slow, the APTs, the advanced threats. How do we go about protecting against those and also sharing that information across the supply chain? So maybe you're protected, but what about everybody you interact with? Because the stuff we've heard about gets you 90, 95, 99%, but it's still the people that are really after you that are the ones that are going to get that data, and that's what we worry about. Thank you.
Okay, good. Thank you. Two very meaty questions. So accountability and liability between parties, individuals, companies, government. And then the second question around, beyond the basics, how do we protect ourselves against the advanced persistent threats, the more sophisticated type of threats that we're seeing an increasing volume of? Natalie, why don't we start with you in terms of accountabilities and liabilities between parties?
Sure. So I expect lots of people are looking across the pond at the moment and seeing what's happening in the US in the Office of Personnel Management. A really significant breach, one which has a number of significant policy as well as operational issues and questions. And we are obviously watching that very closely in terms of how we are developing our own policy here. We can talk about that a bit more, and I'm particularly interested in hearing from companies that operate both sides of the ponds and what that means as well for your individual employees. But I think the crucial bit is that we tend to forget the human dynamic in all of this. And I mean, I did a little bit of that in my opening comments in terms of focusing on organisations and organisational responsibility. But at every level, there are people there, be it the chair of the board, be it actually, I think, a very interesting level, the middle manager who's making decisions around which contracts they are placing with who and why. And then, of course, the end user. And currently, I don't think we quite have hit the mark in terms of where we try to pull levers there to influence. So that's something we're going to do a bit more work on. And there's a lot of interesting stuff going on in academia at the moment around behavioural insights, which will feed into that. Do you want me to come on the second one or just that one?
Yeah, no, please do. I'll certainly move to Jonathan in terms of the APT, but please.
Yeah, I mean, from a national cybersecurity programme point of view, it's well known that the large proportion of our budget goes towards the agencies and the capability that is required to underpin everything else that we do. Sir Ian Lobban, the previous head of GCHQ, made public a programme that they have been working on for some time to provide more information into the public domain, particularly to those companies who we all know are targets for various different reasons. And we should be looking to expand those kinds of arrangements. We are also focusing on developing not only the cert structure that I talked about before, but the SOC structure that sits underneath that, including funding some of Jonathan's work, but also the work in DWP, and as we broaden out into the wider public sector and the information that is held there that maybe might not be that financially valuable, but has huge personal impact to those individuals. And again, happy to talk about that more.
Fantastic, thank you. And Jonathan, in terms of HMRC's approach to deal with the advanced type of threats that you're facing on a day-to-day basis, what's your approach?
I guess the trick there is being very clear about what it is that you're trying to protect the most. So protect the most, the best you can. And as with every large organisation, it's about rings of defence, many layers of defence around the things that you value the most. I suppose the other point here is being clear about not just the data that you value the most, but also the services that you have to protect the most. And we have a pretty good process for judging and assessing which services are most critical to people's lives in the country. So payments out affect people's lives directly. We need to put a lot of security around those sorts of services. So taking a measured approach to our services and data is the only way to do it, really. I obviously won't go into a great deal of detail about how we do that.
Interesting. I think I heard the other week they said there are two types of companies, those who've been hacked and those that don't know that they've been hacked. And on that basis, when we think about the supply chain element of the question that we heard, Ruth, what's your understanding, what are you hearing through your members around how we better protect supply chain from these advanced threats?
Well, I think the key issue with your protecting against advanced persistent threats is that your security policy should be based on the premise that at some point you are going to be breached. The sort of walls of an enterprise are now so large and there are so many surfaces through which it's going to be attacked. That's the basis on which you need to plan. And I think if you look at high-profile breaches like the Sony breach, what was remarkable was not so much that they got in, but the huge extent of user privileges that they had once they were in there. So they were able to walk off with terabytes of the stuff, which they should never have been able to do under any sane security policy. So I think you need to look very closely at the access points that your suppliers have and the privileges they have, the user accounts they have once they're in there. And I think on the liability issue, there are several legislative things in train, such as joint liability under the EU data protection regulations that are going through. I think I can understand why people are quite interested to explore different ways, and I think we need to, but I do think we need to be careful. For example, if we were to adopt joint liability under the GDPR, I think we're going to open up a whole world of pain. If you go to the person who's currently your data controller and there's been a data breach, they have to deal with it. If you go to them under regulation of joint liability, they can say, oh, well, that's not us. That's the data processor somewhere off far away. So you, as the consumer, are left with a much harder job. It will also push up prices for things like cloud technologies, which a lot of SMEs rely on to scale. So I think it's a really difficult debate, one that we need to have, but one that we need to be careful of the knock-on effects.
Thank you. Other questions? In the middle, thank you.
Thanks. Neil Mellor from BT and Inopsis, the trade association. Natalie, you mentioned moving from the CERT to the SOC level, and Jonathan, you talked about your Cyber Command Center earlier on. I'd be interested in your view as to whether this is better done, in other words, that SOC capability is better done at the departmental or local level, or indeed whether it's better done as a sort of shared service, or as GDS might call it, as a platform across government.
Okay, thank you. I'll take one more, and then we'll go to the panel. Pausing for thought there. Natalie. Jonathan, sorry.
Happy to take that. So it's a really good question about where best to do these things. I think it's both, actually, which is quite similar to the model that we've got now. We did look quite hard at whether we should have one command centre, cyber command centre for HMRC and DWP. But understanding the traffic that goes across your networks on at such volume led us to believe that you have to know your traffic well enough to spot the fraud. And that just was too big, trying to do it across both those big government spaces. So it's really about understanding what normal is and watching that like a hawk. And to do that, you've really got to understand in great depth what your services are and how they operate.
Yeah, I mean, I would agree. Part of this is just a sort of naming function. People mean different things, obviously, when they use all these terms. What the important thing is there needs to be the collaborative framework, and I think that's where the platform point comes in. And CERT UK and GDS are currently working on an initiative called SNAP. They were going to call it NAP. The strategic leadership I offered was that we would call it the Security Network Analysis Platform rather than the Network Analysis Platform. And the point of that is providing an opportunity for all of departments to share the data that they currently hold and then produce usable products once rather than replication, which is a problem we deal with at the moment. The SOC structure is still really important, though, when it comes to command and control, and particularly at the pace that we now need to move on a daily basis. There's still some work to do there across government in terms of how we streamline all of that. I mean, I think that's a general theme. I'd absolutely agree with what Ruth was saying earlier. But we're at that stage where we've had nearly 5 years of investment through the National Cybersecurity Programme, developing initiatives like CERT UK, like SNAP, like the Operations Centre. And now is a good moment for reflection in terms of what worked well, what hasn't, and what do we actually need for the next 5 years going forward.
Thank you. Quick question I have myself. We talked, I think, Ruth, you mentioned, is it clear to small businesses or indeed to individuals, perhaps, where do they go if they've suffered a fraud, if they've been attacked? What more do you think we need to do, bearing in mind all the great schemes that we've heard, some of which were announced today, around helping small businesses and helping individuals to kind of combat this threat? But what more do you think we need to do as we see this threat kind of growing in terms of both scale and sophistication over time? Natalie, that's for you.
So I'd challenge the premise of the question slightly. Sometimes I don't think it's necessarily that we need to do more. My okay. point is that actually we should take a moment to reflect on what has worked well, what hasn't. There are a number of different channels and opportunities to engage when you have a cybersecurity challenge, depending on what kind of person or organisation and what's happened to you. The reason for that, quite often, is just because cyber, by its very definition, is incredibly wide-ranging of its impact, and that is part of the challenge. But we do need to do more to streamline the interaction, particularly between the general public, government and the police, and that's some of the work that we are now undertaking.
Thank you. Open up for other questions. Just in the right, thank you.
John Bullard from Identrust. I'd be interested in the panel's observations. We've talked about the word collaborative platform. We've talked about large and small businesses. We've talked about public and private sector. We've talked about business and personal. There's a very good illustration of a collaborative platform that we all use 24/7, and that's the payments network. Do you think that there are lessons and examples and perhaps a way forward to be taken out of the way in which we use the payment systems of this country and globally? And could those sort of lessons be transported and translated into the internet world that is the topic of this conversation?
Thank you for that. In the middle, thank you.
Thank you. Renata Sampson from Big Brother Watch. I'm curious, we've heard an awful lot about consumers today, but there is also, every consumer is also a citizen. And a lot of the data that happens everywhere, not just within government, is personal data as well as transactional data to do with money. There's been a recent court case with regards to Google's use of Safari, and the court found for the first time in the Court of Appeal that actually you can now be challenged on the emotional aspect of a data breach or data loss rather than just on the monetary aspect of it. So I'm curious, as in your discussions about cyber security and security breaches, how much conversation actually takes place where you think about the emotional aspect of the citizen and their private data, as well as the citizen as a consumer? Thank you.
Thank you for that. And of course, there are articles in today's news, of course, around that, some sensitive issues around that as well. Thank you for that. Let's start with the first question, perhaps, around an innovative way of thinking about cyber security and what lessons we might draw from existing platforms, in this case, payments network, almost a chaps, backs and faster payments approach to dealing with cyber incidents. Jonathan, what's your view?
So if I understand the question correctly, you're proposing a way of sharing intelligence around cyber attacks on a platform. Is that the point?
I'm proposing anything of value that moves across electronic networks, of which a payment is a very good example. Are there lessons to be learned from the way the payments networks work, and could they be applied into the wider cyber security field?
Thank you. So I think the point that Natalie just made around this concept of a snap network within government picks up on that theme exactly, where it's a much more rapid sharing of intelligence and knowledge about a cyber attack that's not unsimilar to a chaps approach in a way. So I think that's where we are now. In a way, that's kind of how antivirus works now in any case, albeit provided by separate providers. So yeah, I think there are opportunities there.
Thank you. Natalie?
I would agree. I think also one of the things we sometimes forget about cybersecurity is we get quite obsessed with the new network or the new platform that we've just built. And actually, one of the biggest challenges we have is understanding how the old infrastructure that we've been using for the last 20, 30 years now interacts with that which we've just built in the last couple of years. And actually, the two are incredibly interconnected and often very reliant. So we can't afford not to look at the lessons from previous systems and understand how they're all going to integrate together.
Thank you. And then on the second question, does that answer your question? It's an interesting point. And there are, I mean, and having spent 20 years in banking, when you look at the platforms that do already exist, the infrastructure, the controls, the protocols around how banks and, in fact, all their counterparties interact, I think there can be lessons that can be learned from that, so that we don't have to kind of reinvent the wheel. So an interesting point and one that I've not heard before. On the second question, very interesting. How much are we considering the emotional impact, the personal impact, beyond just financial loss of breaches? And I talked about what's going on in the news today around people's social media accounts or being hacked or photos being hacked and posted online, type of distress that can cause. Ruth, what's your view?
I think it's an area that's been neglected. I would agree. We've been talking to victim support. What they've told us is that one of the hardest things for people to come to terms with is the emotional aspect of being sort of a victim of an online fraud. They feel very stupid. They feel ashamed. They feel like they shouldn't have fallen for that. And I don't think there is enough there to support people and to help them, in coming forward, and also to help them deal with the emotional aspect. I think there's also an issue there when it comes to how private companies use people's data. There's a lot of discussion in the media, and of course Big Brother Watch has been very involved in how sort of looking at the national security discussion and how government use citizens' data and that. But I think what perhaps has been less picked up on is what all the different private sector companies you interact with online do with your data every day and what you sign up to. So every time I want to buy a train ticket, I want to book a restaurant online through some app or something, I get presented with what, hundreds maybe, of pages of terms and conditions. Who in their right mind is going to do that? You'd spend all day reading through terms and conditions just to book a couple of tickets and do a couple of sort of life admin jobs. I think that's something we really need to address. We have to make this more user-friendly. We can't go along as we are, because people simply don't know who's got their data and what you're going to do with their data and what they've signed up to. So Tech UK is working with the Information Economy Council at the moment to develop principles for sort of clear statements for consumers about what companies will do with their data and what it is they're committing to. And I think we need to see a much bigger push for that.
Thank you. Jonathan or Natalie, do you want to...
Yeah, great question. Does HMRC take into account the emotional impact of a breach? I'm very proud to say yes, we do, a lot, actually. What you measure in the way of breaches can sometimes force you down a financial route, but I have to say, in HMRC, we take the emotional impact of a breach on a customer very seriously. And if one person has their data affected, that can have a huge impact on their personal lives. And that's right at the forefront of our thinking, right up to board level, I have to say.
Thank you. Natalie, any comments on that?
No, I think we're a violent agreement. The fact is, particularly from a government perspective, the range of data that we now hold, yes, it's financial records in HMRC, but it's health records, it's educational records, it's everything in terms of impacts on people's lives. So it's a very difficult process to go through when there is a data breach. And I think it comes back to the fact that civil servants take this all very seriously, because the fact is it could have been then, or they could have been one of them. And again, that's what we're seeing in the States, that lots of the people involved are actually affected themselves. And so we do need to make sure we've got the right processes in place to make sure that that happens. And that's an evolving process, because the nature of all of these systems and interactions and services are continuing to develop, and we have to keep up with that.
And an interesting point as well, kind of that perhaps we don't have time today to debate, around that scrutiny that is applied to both the use and the protection of data by government agencies versus private sector companies. So why do people perhaps feel quite concerned giving their data over perhaps to the HMRC versus giving it to Tesco or to Google quite readily, and actually they're using it for commercial reasons as opposed to reasons to either protect or to service citizens. So a very interesting debate, perhaps not for now, potentially for another conference. Our time perhaps just for one last question, and then we will wrap up. Any burning last questions? The room goes silent.
Can I come in there, Curtis?
Please do, yeah.
So you just prompted a thought there for me, which was we're just about to go back around the loop of trying to figure out what to measure in the security space on continual challenge. One of the things that I'm thinking about at the moment, and it's not formalised yet, is measuring customer confidence in HMRC security. If citizens have confidence that I do a good job, if you like, in HMRC, then that drives a much stronger digital take-up and loads of other benefits as well. So if I can find a way of measuring customer citizen confidence in the security of HMRC and how we handle data, I think that would drive very positive thinking within my organisation.
Fantastic. Thank you for that. So just a couple of notes really from me, just to sum up and then give my thanks to the panel members. So Natalie, we've heard you talk about the programmes that are already in place to foster collaboration and what we're doing to kind of better prepare ourselves to both detect and respond to cyber attacks. Interesting to hear you talk about the tools. So actually what might be the future role for things like cyber insurance, and actually how can we move to better and more real-time information sharing with an increased demand on services such as CISP, which is fascinating. From Jonathan, from your side, from HMRC, kind of actually what's happening on the ground, how are you actually applying some of these measures to address the challenges that we face. You don't have to shout about security. I think we're all probably quite relieved to hear you say that. And you hold board members to account, which I thought was an interesting point, actually how we shift that accountability to the people who are responsible. And then obviously a lot of conversation around consolidating data into one place, the risks, but also the benefits of that, which leads on neatly to a very positive message, Ruth, from yourself, which is how do we move the discussion, how do we move our language beyond just fear, uncertainty and doubt into an area that talks about the positive benefits of cyber security and cyber resilience and how it can be an enabler both for businesses, for citizens, and in fact, for the public and for the UK more generally, and how we get the right balance of protection versus the need for privacy, the need to protect the UK as a whole, but also that balance between innovation and business growth. A very interesting set of discussions. So it just leaves me to thank the panel members for their fascinating contribution. Please join me in thanking Natalie, Jonathan and Ruth.